Welcome, everyone, also in the name of KDE. It's really great to have you all here. 2016 is a very special year for KDE. We've made a lot of technical advances that you will hear more about during the rest of the conference. But KDE is also turning 20 years, which for a free software project is a remarkable achievement. And this conference, yes. And this conference is also our way to celebrate those 20 years and plan for the next 20 years and more. But we've also done something really important for the community in 2016 already, which is write down our vision. It has not been an easy process, but we've come to agree that we strive for a world in which everyone has control over their digital life and enjoys freedom and privacy. This is really important in today's world, and we, KDE, can't do this alone. So I'm really thrilled to have this conference together with you to foster our ecosystem and get us closer to that vision. So of the people who consider themselves part of KDE, who is at their first Akademy? Can you please stand up? Yay! This is the perfect conference to have your first Akademy. For you and everyone else, have a great conference. Make good use of all the great communities we have here. Thank you.
And next, please welcome Jean-Baptiste Kempf of Videolan.
I'm very happy to see all you guys. For Videolan and VLC, 2016 is also an important year. We VLC started by a student project 20 years ago, But at the time, the goal was just to find a good way to destroy a network to play Doom on a campus. And that was a Project Network 2000. And it became VLC only a few years later and became open source in 2001, which is 15 years ago. So this year is also our 15 years of actually doing open source code. So usually we do the Videolan Dev Days in September because it's 6 months after the first dem. And usually we are just a bunch of hackers, 60, 70 of us. So it's quite interesting to be with all you guys. When Lydia suggested that we should do a joint conference, we thought it was a good idea because VLC uses Qt since 2009, 2008 and 2009. And we have around, 300 million users using the Qt version of VLC, which is quite large. But also a lot more people from KDE were coming to VDD and a lot of people came to Akademy. So it made sense to join us, and I hope it's going to be great. Please come to the Videolan session about encoders tomorrow. They might be a bit technical, but they're going to be fun, I promise. Thank you, everyone, and good luck. Have fun.
And finally, please welcome Erik Albers of the FSFE.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Erik from the Free Software Foundation Europe. I'd like to thank the Qt company, KDE and VLC for this great opportunity to bring together so many communities. And I like to highlight that we also have 15 years of existence, the FSFE, and we are using QtCon to celebrate our 15 years of existence. And therefore, therefore, you are welcome to join us tomorrow at 4:30. There will be an official celebration of our existence in room B5 and B6. And tomorrow in the evening, there's also an official celebration in the C-Base, the most famous hackerspace here in Berlin, where you're also welcome to join us. Finally, today, we have the topic of business. All our talks today are about business with free software. I think this could be an interest to many people of you. Check out our schedule. Now I'd like to wish all of us, participants and organizers, an inspiring and joyful weekend. Thanks.
Right, so now all of you should have a better idea of who everybody else in the room is and what they're about. And I guess you're thinking now, why is that support act clown still on stage? And why is the band that we came to see for not here yet? So it's about time to unleash the conference program upon you. And this is not just any conference program. It's pages and pages and pages. There are no less than 142 speakers presenting in or presiding over 166 sessions and talks and presentations. So you're probably going to be very tired by the time you get out of here. About a year ago in this very room, I sat on one of those chairs that you are sitting now and attended one of the keynotes of the Qt World Summit at that time, which was held by Kenneth Sukier, the data editor of The Economist, who gave a very fascinating presentation about big data. And he talked about how companies are data mining massive amounts of data to learn new things that we didn't have knowledge about before. I particularly vividly remember an example that just by data mining its search queries, Google was able to predict flu outbreaks before they even had broken out. But this was about data that was not accessible to everybody. It was about data that Google owns, that airlines own, that governments own. And now we're hearing about a different perspective. We're going to hear about how open data can make life for people a lot better. So I'm very happy to introduce our first keynote speaker, Raul Krauthausen, who will speak about how social activists are using data. Give a big hand to Raul.
Yeah. Good morning. My name is Raul, and I came together with
yeah. Hello, my name is Holger.
And together we founded 12 years ago a nonprofit organization called Sozialhelden. And it means social heroes in English. And we had the idea that maybe we can empower people to do good without having to study something social, without having to read a lot of books. We just wanted to make a social engagement attractive, like watching YouTube. And our first idea was an offline idea. It was, it's called a Fantastisch Helfen. And it's a solution for supermarkets where when you bring back your empty bottles, you get in Germany a deposit bill. I don't know if it's in your country the same, but in Germany you get around about 25 cents per bottle back when you bring the bottles back to the supermarket. So you try to avoid waste. And we had the idea, maybe we can donate those bottles or these deposit bills to charity organizations. And we started with this idea in 2007, in Berlin and started collecting for a company which is called Berliner Tafel. And the company, the non-profit organization is, needs this money to share meal to people who are in need. And so we had the idea, how would it be if people could donate their deposit bills gained by empty bottles and donate it to charity organizations? And we started in the first year with one box. And now we have only in Germany, in Berlin, 100 boxes and collect around about 100,000 euros a year only by deposit bills for the Berliner Tafel. And now this project has grown. Now we are in 400 supermarkets all over Germany, and it's a very hard business because you have to deal with supermarkets, and supermarket owners are kind of complicated people because there's no chain in Germany. You have a lot of single shop owners, and it's very hard to convince more than one shop at a time to work with us. But 400 is a very good number, and now we asked ourselves, okay, what could be our next project? Because this idea we had in 2007. And although we are social activists, we also love open data. And that's your part.
Yeah, so I'm here today to tell you a little story about actually Raul and me. We studied together and we had ideas like Fantastisch Helfen and others and discussed them. But it was always at the same coffee shop where Raul lived in the neighborhood where he lived. So I asked him, like, why do we always go to the same cafe, Raul?
It's because it was the only cafe I knew which was wheelchair accessible. And it's not only my problem, it's a lot of people's problem, like families with strollers, elderly people, or people who have a broken leg, or a lot of baggage.
So we said it was in 2007-08, something like that. And we said, like, why, if you have this problem and you know in your neighborhood, so there must be other people in other neighborhoods who know the coffee shop that, where they can go, and the restaurant, and the swimming pool, and everything. So shouldn't there be a service, like a cloud-based service, that was a big word back then, to say, you know, where everybody can just mark the places they know, so when you go to their neighborhood, you will know where to go around, and we can go to different coffee shops.
But it was clear that when we are talking to people about accessibility of a place, it is very important to tell them what we need, which kind of information. And so we have to break down the complexity of accessibility to a traffic light system like a red, a yellow, and green to tell people if a place is accessible or not. And of course, it should be for free, because nobody would pay for information if a place is accessible or to being rated if my place is accessible.
So but by the time it happened that I learned about OpenStreetMap, which some of you might already have thought about, and I told him, well, this is an awesome community of people who are building a map of the whole world from scratch. It's actually all there, right? And then there was a wiki page and some development code, and we're both not developers, totally not. I tried it once, it was terrible. So I respect a lot of how hard it might be. And we said, okay, we can maybe hack something together, maybe something else will happen, or the big players will implement this information. But it stuck in our head to say, you know, there's an open solution where this information is already there, and we could maybe do it someday. But we didn't have the resources to do that.
And you remember our first project, which was called Fantastisch Helfen. It happened that in 2009, we won a prize with this idea. We won around about 10,000 euros. And so we had the idea, okay, how would it be if we would use this money and give it to a friend who is a developer and let him build the first version of Wheelmap?
And we did this, and this is what it looks today. So it is actually just what we imagined, and we're still working on this, a map where you can see already a lot of places, millions of places, and all you need to do is add the color like on a traffic light system.
So now you can rate if a place is accessible in the entrance, or and if it has an accessible toilet for people in wheelchairs, and you also can upload photos.
And people started using it. So this is an example from 2011, where somebody said, it really helped me. I marked a lot of places. It changed the way I can, you know, find my way and get around in my daily life. And that's actually what we hope would happen. And it was a really exciting moment for us to have this crappy first version online. And we went out throughout our neighborhoods and said, there's a step in the entrance and there's another one. And then we stopped and then was another day. And the day afterward, we saw that somebody else did the same thing. And we had no idea who that was. And that was a marvelous moment, actually, to see. And the day after, there were another 50 places by somebody we didn't know.
And we believe it is because we use the OpenStreetMap, because there have already been a lot of places which you only had to add additional information if it's accessible or not. If we would have started with an empty map without any point of interest on it, nobody would add a postcode or a street name or a house number or a name of a place because it's too complex.
So people started using it all over the world, actually. So we got tweets from people like, why don't you have wheel map in Japan? And we're like, we don't know anything in Japan, but it's actually, you know, worldwide data. So they said, like, can we translate it maybe to Japanese? And we're like, well, we cannot right now, but maybe we can, you know, add YAML files and translate them somewhat. So they did. So we have people in many countries now who translated actually in 22 languages. We are online right now through a volunteer community of people who just said, I like that. I like this in Russian, in Italian, in Japanese. And we even have somebody who uses it in Klingon.
Yeah, actually, the Klingon version is the only version with a three-letter language code. TLH.
So TLH. So the way we grew, we had no marketing budget, and also, we built a solution for ourselves, and we're happy that people are using it, but we started to tell the people to the local media. Like, we are from Berlin, so it was like in the Berlin radio, and then was in the national television once. And so it grew organically from there, because more and more people learned from the idea, and they could just download the app or go to the website and mark places. And there was a big point for us when we said, okay, this works, and we can tell the story again and again. And one example of a really big media impact we had was when we did a advertising campaign. Yeah.
And please take note to the attribution of OpenStreetMap.
In the following video.
Rollstuhlfahrer gibt, allein in Deutschland, dann heißt das doch, dass es auch 1,6 Millionen Menschen gibt, die rollstuhlgerechte Orte kennen.
So, thanks.
So, as mentioned before, we tried to build bridges between open data, nonprofit, social causes, and of course, to the maximum reach. So, the bigger our platform becomes, the better it is. And so, we also try to work with companies together.
And what the speakers in the beginning said, like, how could commercial things and open source things go together? I think this is a great example that, you know, a company you might know also running a map service endorses this, and there was no Google Maps in the Google spot, and it was fine for them. So we like that, actually. And this is a way you can see how the marking of places changed after the video spot. And it went on like this, and today we have 690,000 marked places on OpenStreetMap and on WheelMap, of course, then.
So we are syncing it back to the OpenStreetMap every minute.
Yeah, so it's a syncing service. So also what we, so we grew with that and we could build more, and we found people who said, why don't you have this on iOS? And we said, well, why don't you build something if you want to? And it went, and we learned more and more about this and became more and more professional also with funds we got. And today we're on iOS, Android, even Windows 10. And of course the website is also mobile friendly. And also all this, what we develop is open source. So fork us in GitHub, we are always happy to have new contributors. But we are also actively maintaining this.
And talking about building bridges, we also want to empower people like social communities, like schools, like students, like organizations who are more in offline doing something. We want to empower them and encourage them to map their neighborhoods, like school classes. And now we had the idea to bring mobile phones to classrooms. Actually, children love it. Children love having their mobile phones in the classroom. And so we made kind of a school lesson where they learn about what is a place, when is a place accessible, why is accessibility needed, and how you can help to rate your neighborhood with your mobile phone in a classroom. And we got a lot of traction with that, and we call this events mapping parties.
It's like the same what is called an open street map.
We're mapping parties.
Yeah. And maybe one more word to that. It's also helping them learn that they can empower themselves and mark places themselves. And also they learn about open street map and how mapping actually works, while also learning about inclusion, because our goal is equal access to public places, equal participation in daily life, no matter if you're using a wheelchair or not.
And the younger the students are, we talk to them, the more open they are about this topic. They want to learn something. And the kind of the feeling of inequality for young people is higher than when we get older. But talking about marking a place, if it's accessible or not, doesn't make a place accessible. So a lot of places are not accessible, like a cafe or a restaurant, because they have 2 or 1 step in the entrance. And to be honest, it's no rocket science to overcome those steps. So we ask ourselves, what is the biggest struggle for a coffee shop owner to buy a ramp? And the biggest problem for them is they don't know where to find. So we started an online shop, which is called Wheel Ramp, where you can buy a ramp for the map. We call it wheelramp.de, and it's a one single product shop. So only one product, one solution for 180 euros, you can buy a ramp. Eat it or leave it, but don't tell us there's no ramp. So that's kind of our activism model.
And we do this not because this completely could finance our nonprofit organization, but to inspire people that things can be changed and can be fixed, and that we of course understand that they're old buildings and we don't want to tear down old buildings, but simple things can fix simple problems.
But there's a problem. There are some places like a train station with an elevator, which is sometimes accessible and sometimes not, because the elevator might be broken. So what do we do with this temporary information? It's very hard to crowdsource if an elevator is broken, because everyone would rate if an elevator is broken, but nobody would tell us if the elevator is working. So you can't crowdsource this information. And then we found out that in Berlin especially, we have 2 public transport providers. We have the Deutsche Bahn, which is running the S-Bahn, and we have the BVG, which is running the underground. And both companies are not talking to each other, but both have elevators. And both of them show if their elevators are broken or not, because some of the elevators are online. And when you use the public transport system in Berlin, sometimes you don't know which kind of provider you're using. So it's a very awkward situation to figure out if the elevator you are using might be broken or not, because you don't know which provider you're using. Especially, for example, here at the Alexanderplatz, where the underground is crossing the S-Bahn, where you don't know who belongs the elevator to. It's a tricky situation. And so we had the idea, how would it be if we build a website which we call Broken Lifts, next slide, which we call Broken Lifts, where we merge those RSS feeds of the BVG website and of the S-Bahn website to make a user-friendly version which only tells you how the name of the station is, and it doesn't matter which provider is using it. And what happens is that now we started doing it by scraping illegally the data from their websites.
Don't tell anyone.
And 2 years later, the Berlin government asked us if we could do it officially. And then we said, okay, if you pay us, then we asked them, if you pay us, we can do this. And when you work with governmental organizations like the S-Bahn or the BVG, you have to talk a lot with a lot of people, although the technological side is a very small one. And so it came out, we are not allowed to tell if an elevator is broken, but we are allowed to tell if it's working or not. So the because there might be different situations why it's not working, and it's not always broken. So the compromise was, we use the word Broken Lifts as a company name or as a project name, but afterwards we only tell about außer Betrieb or not. So you understand the political side on that. And now in Germany, in Berlin, we have 400 and plus elevators, and you can see on this slide, 30 of them are broken yesterday, have been broken yesterday. And so it's not every elevator is broken, but some.
So it's actually one more perspective of this. We learned a lot why things are complicated and how deep, like in these large organizations, there is some data and nobody thought about different use cases. So it needed this actually to inspire the German railway system to say, well, this is actually useful data, and there's something called open data, and now they officially released this as an open data. So they started their open data strategy this year,
last year,
and the first use case was broken elevators, because it was so obvious why this would be needed. And so in the end, we inspired them to open up their data. And this is the impact things like this can have. So what would a hero do next? So our idea is, okay, there's data we can, which can be crowdsourced by awesome communities like OpenStreetMap and everybody who's using WheelMap. But there's also a lot of other data. And so our idea is, couldn't we fix this in a way that information, whether a place is accessible or not, is just wherever people are looking for this information? So look at this world map. This is what where WheelMap is, or where OpenStreetMap places are right now. But if you dig deeper into it, there's a lot of white spots and lots of places not accessible. And also, we are not the only nonprofit organization who did an app like this. There are other apps in other countries, like Jacques said, in France, or AccessMap in the United States, who have similar crowdsourcing efforts, but they're not using OpenStreetMap. So, and also, so there's data from companies, there's data from nonprofit organizations and open data, and also there's data from governments, because there's a lot of open data strategy now going on the municipal level for cities, on the country level. So I found more than 1,000 sources of open data portals in different cities on the whole world. And what often happens is that those government organizations, they have information about the infrastructure, be it toilets in public parks, but also places of touristic interest, for example, are usually mapped whether they are wheelchair accessible or not. But they all have different data structures, and they are scattered around the whole world, actually. And what I would like to see is that it not only shows up in wheel map one day, but wherever people are looking for this information and whatever app or device they might be using. Because this is what we think should be disability mainstreaming, that people could just, you know, go around their daily lives like people without wheelchairs do, and just this information is available. So what we are working on right now is something we call accessibility.cloud. And what we want to do is talk to the people who own this data or who have this data, whether they might open it up to an open license or not, and also understand their data structure and the quality of the data, and put them together in a joint data set, which then can be pulled by others who want to display this information. So it should be like a cloud-based service, not truly a service, with an API where people can be source providers, but also receivers of information.
So because, imagine a few years ago, in a few years, you might ask Siri if it can tell you a restaurant which is accessible nearby. And Siri should give you an answer, and it doesn't matter where the information comes from. Or imagine you're sitting in a BMW and you talk to your navigation system in your car, run by here.net. How about asking this navigation software if a restaurant nearby is accessible?
So, and it should be easy and usable. So we have some partnerships today, for example, with the Yellow Pages in Germany, where with the listings of these different shops, there's information in case there's some information from WheelMap and OpenStreetMap available. So we convinced them to do that. But it would be very cumbersome for them to discuss with everybody who has data. So we hope we make this one service where if you connect once, you get all the data you might get, and this technically you have to implement it only once. And it's also what we built should be completely open source. And this, we're building the first prototype of this right now. So it stays to say what we want you to encourage. And if you have any geo data or related to this, or maybe other use cases you might not have thought of, we want to urge you to use open data and also share place data you might have.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a truly inspiring presentation. I'm sure there's a lot of volunteers in here already, but let's hear some questions first.
Yeah.
Please raise your hand if you have a question, and David and I will do our daily exercise running out to you. Yes?
Another question in the back?
Is that a hand down there?
And there's also one.
No.
Yes, thank you. Will there also be a feature where people can travel from point A to B without restriction or with escalators or stuff like this? Google Street Maps for person in a wheelchair.
You mean for other use cases, like for other kinds of disabilities, you mean? Or, I didn't get the question, sorry.
Sorry, I didn't understand you.
Can you repeat the question, please? Routing. Okay. Well, for the public, for the Berlin use case with the public transportation, for example, they plan to use this so that if your route is not available because one elevator is broken, it should suggest a different route. But it's not our role. We want to inspire them to update their routing services. So on WheelMap itself, we are only about points of interest or places, and we don't have any routing. And routing also can be very messy very quickly because there are different kinds of disabilities. So we know of some projects who try to sense the ground, for example, if it's hard, if the surface on the ground is hard to use with a wheelchair, for example. And it's also, it's a much harder to get this information by, you know, by volunteers. So a step in the entrance is like the easiest we could think of.
And when you sit in a wheelchair, there's a very, very neat workaround. When you want to route yourself from A to B, just use the bike navigation. Because it avoids steps and stairs.
Thanks for the inspiring talk. One question?
There's a question.
Sorry. Here.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks for the inspiring talk. So, are you working on changing policies to, for example, making more data open data? For example, I could imagine a lot of infrastructure has elevators or things which can break. And so it's probably good that they now follow up and do these things mm-hmm. open data, but I guess like it's also we should ask the government to like change policies to whatever, do a free software and also open data more and more.
Of course. So you have our contact details. If you have ideas, we can surely join forces on doing
Thanks.
That.
No, but honestly, what we think is a very concrete example goes a long way in this kind of abstract discussion for lots of time. So we learn a lot that WheelMap is an example on like why you should open data. And actually, even elevator manufacturers are contacting us and say like, oh, that's interesting. And do you know we have maybe more data? And what could be our contribution to this? And that's our opportunity to tell, no, it's not about wheelchair drivers, it's about opening up your data, or that you have data others might be interested in using in ways you never expected. So that's our approach, very concrete, and then tell them the big story.
So what we found out is the biggest issue is a policy issue, and it's not the technological complexity. Although we have a lot of big trouble running technology, like deduplication of different data sources, it's a very complex problem. But the biggest barriers in working on open data is really changing mindsets and talking to politicians or company owners who have fear of losing control.
I think the biggest step is that they say, like, but who guarantees that this will be 100% correct? And then our answer is, we have no idea, you know, and but we hope this will work. And then we have something like, did you ever use Wikipedia? You know, things might go wrong, and that's all we can say. And this letting go of a perceived control is a big step for them.
So nobody's responsible, but everyone.
Yeah. Hi. Also, thank you very much for doing this. As a Berlin citizen, the election is coming up in 2 weeks. Can you say something, which party is supporting you most? Maybe give some hint, because there is this one survey tool, Valomat or so, but I can't remember that regarding such issues there was any question, so.
When I made the Valomat, it got me 97% matching with the pirates, a pirate party. So it's obvious which party.
So you're private, but as a non-profit organization, we don't endorse any political parties. That's not our role. So we talk to all the parties who are interested in that. And no matter what the government is, we have our stand. So, for example, we had in Munich a thing that happened that there are other projects which were much smaller than WheelMap, and they were doing this just in the vicinity, and they got government funding for this. And so the grantor said, like, oh, we don't need this anymore.
Because
and then we wrote them a letter like, what the fuck, you know, that's totally not what we think, that you should step back in your governmental role to fix this issue. We're just showing you how big the issue is, basically. But we are not, and we are happy to work with all democratic parties, to fix this.
But what we want to do is, and that's why we call ourselves activists, we don't want to run big platforms being known worldwide. What we want to do is change laws. So we want to show with WheelMap how big the problem is worldwide. And we want, for example, to convince the German government to make stronger laws that a place has to be accessible. and there's no kind of backdoor for a restaurant to not becoming accessible. You understand what I mean? So we need more stronger laws.
Works better in other countries.
Yeah, like
more questions or comments.
Don't be shy.
There's one.
Yes, one.
You said you tried technology once and gave up. I think we have a lot of people here in the room who try technology and never gave up. So my question would be, how can people like us who are able to write applications, to run web services or whatever, how can we help you in what you are doing in the best way?
Okay, so talking of the stack we're using, basically, so how it works is like our backend service is a Ruby on Rails application, and it's managed by an agency. It's all open source on GitHub, and this then is providing an API which feeds then all the apps we have. And these app is what we update like two or three times a year, and depending on the funding we get, and we are very happy to have more volunteers on that. So also, we are happy to look on different use cases of this kind of data or of what we have. So we have actually a wrapper or like a second API just for the wheel map use case. So everything you can use on wheel map, like authenticate with OpenStreetMap, create places, add photos, mark places, is also available for the wheel map API. And in the backend, we have a service syncing it back within minutes to OpenStreetMap. In case OpenStreetMap is down, which almost never happens, I know, but so we have a queue and send this back. So it actually has a lot of work went into this, but we are confident since, so I'm very proud of the developers, and I think it's not like a huge bunch of legacy code nobody wants to look at, but it's actually pretty up to date, I would say. And
thanks to Askera.
Yeah, and they are actually also very active in the open source community, and they help us also moderate this process. You know, we have bugs on our issue tracker, say like it's easy and mentored, and you can start sending pull requests. And it's not me to decide whether this issue is easy or mentored, because they need to do it. So we are very happy to have this support. And same goes for the mobile app. So if you're interested in improving the iOS app or the Android app, also it's all open source. And we're happy to see other use cases as well. So easiest is GitHub, search for Sozialhelden, that's our repository, or email us, and we'll put you in touch with people you can really talk to.
Then I have a question here. Mm-hmm. The collecting of whatever it's called in English, the money you get back from handing in your bottles at shops, mm-hmm. You mentioned that you needed to go from shop to shop to convince them to put this up. And it sounded like this is mostly in Berlin or Germany. How about in here? I'll bet you that there's not a European country that's not represented here. If any of us wanted to go home to our countries and start initiatives like that, what would the next step be?
So starting doing what? Collecting bottles?
Well, collecting
the in different countries.
Okay. Well, of course, you can contact us if you have the idea for your country, and then we can tell you how we started. And how we produce these boxes, for example, and how we make it sustainable. So, of course, we have worked with this project, so we have license fees, and we tell you everything, what we learned, and what we might be do a difference the next time if we would start it from scratch. And of course, feel open.
Basically, if you run a small nonprofit organization in your neighborhood, what really works well is that those activists then, they go to the shop in their city and they say like, this is for the community right around your shop, and this is where the money will go. And all we do is we empower both parties to make this kind of deal, to say like, how does it work? Is it safe? Will somebody get hurt by this box? Really, I'm not kidding. And you know, how can you mount this? How will the money be transferred? This kind of things. So we're not involved in the money transfer and things like that, but we help them set this relationship up, and then they run it basically. So.
But I imagine there's also a lot of legal implication in this. I mean, if I go to my neighbor and I say, can you give some money for this charity? Next thing I'll see is the police will be knocking on my door for collecting money for
unregistered charities and so on.
You have to be a registered charity, of course.
Right.
So but I can't help you with that.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but what works best is having a supermarket collecting money for a kindergarten nearby. So the social responsibility of the supermarket shows up for the neighborhood.
And it's easy. That's was our whole goal to say, like, both for everybody. You know, the supermarket owner can do something good, and it's not like a marketing strategy or something. They just put this in their shop.
Anybody else?
Okay, I might have one more thing. So I know it's mostly developers, but I'm looking for an intern for product management of everything we talked about, just to pitch this.
For WIMAP.
If you have somebody who wants to be a VAC student or intern with us, email me or talk to me after this.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Thanks.